Welcome to the video brew log of Joey and Nick's medieval ale recreation. First, let's meet our brewmasters. The ale we brew for this project is just that, an ale, not a beer. We'll explain the difference along the way, but ale in High Middle Age England was a drink for all folk, highborn and low, lord or serf. Judith Bennett, in her book Ale, Beer, and Brewsters in England, cites writings of an ale produced in the household of Elizabeth de Burgh, Lady of Clare in England's county of Suffolk, northeast of London. To avoid a potential biohazard and a phone call from the guys down the road at the CDC, we use modern equipment and sterilization techniques to ensure that our medieval ale will be true to form, but also safe to drink. So, from the beginning. As I mentioned before, we used modern sterilization techniques. So here I am sterilizing our brew vessel, the large white bucket, the airlock, which we'll meet later, and now our grain sack, which will be used to hold our grain for the brew. The first step was to boil the 6 quarts of water you see here before we add that to our brew vessel and our grain. Here I am dumping out our cleaning solution, so now we have a sterilized brew vessel. Here I am opening up our bag of grains. Keeping to the de Burgh ratio, it contains 5 pounds of pale English malt, a kind of wheat, and 1.5 pounds of rolled oats. You can see me mixing up the grains so that we have the two grains well mixed before adding it to our brew vessel. Now is as good a time as any to explain why I said that we are making an ale, not a beer. Many of you may know that any beer you've heard of contains hops, an ingredient absent from our recipe. Hops are the little green pine cone looking things you see here that are actually the female flower clusters of the hop plant. Hops, a few centuries down the road, were discovered to be a bittering agent that helped preserve the taste and nutritional value of the beer. Our ale, however, true to the 14th century de Burgh recipe, has no hops, just malt and oats. We'll begin adding things to our brew vessel by first adding 2 quarts of water before any grain is added. Notice how I'm pouring it from a height so that a lot of it gets into a vapor form. This will really help capture the flavor from our grains. Here we are now adding our grain to our brew vessel. There's the 2 quarts of boiling hot water in the bottom, and on top of this we'll add the grains. We now put the brew vessel in some insulation, and yes, that is a sleeping bag. We'll add a little bit more hot boiling water, and then we'll seal up the vessel to allow that to stew for 30 minutes or so. Once we open the beer back up, we give it a quick stir, add a little bit more boiling water, seal it up, and this time leave it for 3 hours or so, again letting the grain steep in the boiling water. We open up the brew vessel. There's the mush that we have right now. We're going to add our last 7 quarts of water, bringing us to a total of 13 quarts of boiling water added up until this point. That'll be all the water. Give it a quick stir when we're ready to move on to the next step. Now for the fun part. The whole reason we placed the grains in a bag was so we could just lift them right out. This leaves behind the sugary wort, or liquid, In medieval times, a bag like this may not have been used, but the grains were strained out in some way. Finally, it's time to seal up the wort and let it cool. But before we do that, let's first turn back to our friend, the airlock. The airlock is one of our modern sanitary techniques. Once we add yeast to the brew vessel, the airlock will become more useful as it will allow carbon dioxide to escape the vessel without allowing contaminants into the vessel. But for now, it just forms a good tight seal for our wort to cool. We'll go ahead and let the wort cool overnight and add yeast in the morning. Good morning. Time to get our yeast culture going before we add it to the wort. Yeast is what makes ale, ale. The yeast is responsible for adding the fun stuff. That's right, ethanol. Yeast is a microscopic organism found everywhere. It'll consume the sugar in the wort and produce ethanol and carbon dioxide as waste products. Our yeast comes dehydrated and needs to be warmed up, bought from a homebrew store. Back in medieval times, the yeast would have been nice and fresh, more than likely the very yeast that would be growing on the unwashed grain in the first place. Now yeast, just like you or I, need to consume oxygen for metabolic function. And there's only one way to get a good amount of oxygen dissolved in our wort. Now it's time to add in the yeast, give it one last good shake, and seal it up for 72 to 96 hours. It's been almost 96 hours, and we see no more carbon dioxide coming out of the airlock. That means the yeast have produced as much ethanol as they're gonna produce. Time to open it up and see what we got. In medieval times, ale was made fresh and served almost immediately when it was done fermenting. If it was stored, it was stored in barrels. We, however, are going to use the modern method of bottling our beer. So you'll see Nick here pouring it into a glass bottle, and we'll use a specific capping device to place a fresh cap on the bottle.
Tastes like before?
More or less. Maybe a little more sour than it was.
Sour?
Mm-hmm. Tastes like bread.
Tastes like mashed. It does.
Cheers.
Refreshing.